All right, welcome everybody. I just want to provide a short little lecture here on searches in the criminal justice system, because this week one of your assignments has you dealing with searches by different practitioners of the criminal justice system, those basically being a police officer, a probation officer, and a correctional officer. So I wanted to give you some additional insight as to some of the legal issues surrounding each of those types of searches. So how hopefully that will help you with your discussion board assignment this week. So first thing we need to talk about is the Fourth Amendment, because the Fourth Amendment is the guiding law on searches and seizures in this country. And so I just want to recap what the Fourth Amendment says. Basically, the Fourth Amendment says the right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, paper, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizures shall not be violated, and no warrants shall issue but upon probable cause supported by oath or affirmation, and particularly describing the place to be searched and the persons or things to be seized. And I think the key phrase here, the key word here, is unreasonable, because who decides what's unreasonable? Well, the answer to that is the courts. The courts determine whether or not a search should be reasonable or unreasonable. So that interpretation will come into play not only on some of the police searches we'll talk about here, but also probation and those conducted by correctional officers. Okay, so the key word I think is unreasonable. So again, interpreting what is an unreasonable search. So that is basically the language of the Fourth Amendment. The essential elements are, from our perspective as criminal justice practitioners, are unreasonable searches and seizures are prohibited. So any search that is deemed to be unreasonable is going to be prohibited. Search and arrest warrants must be based upon probable cause and must specifically identify items to be seized, searched for, or persons to be searched. So this level of probable cause is the standard that the police have to have. Probable cause is not the standard for a probation officer or a parole officer, and probable cause is not the standard for a correctional officer. It is, however, the standard for a police officer if they are going to conduct a search or arrest someone. They need to have probable cause. The police. So, in pretty simple terms, in order for the police to conduct a legal search, they need to have probable cause, right? And they either need to have a search warrant, or absent a search warrant, an exigent circumstance, or an exception to the search warrant rule. So for example, automobiles. Automobiles are the exception to the search warrant rule. You still have to have probable cause to search an automobile, but the Supreme Court has ruled that a search warrant is not required. And so when you take a course here in constitutional law, they'll go into that a little bit further, okay? So, but why is it that police, for example, have to have probable cause to conduct a search, and probation and parole officers don't, and prison officials don't? I want you to think about that. I'm not going to give you the answer, but think about why a police officer in our society needs to have probable cause, and those other criminal justice practitioners do not, in order to conduct a search. Okay, so just think about that. So let's talk about probation officers. Now, probation officers obviously are supervising individuals who could have been sentenced to jail and then probation, or could have been an individual who strictly received probation. If a person is on parole, that generally means that he has done some time in state prison and is now continuing that supervision out in society, and therefore he's supervised by a parole officer. So let's briefly talk about searches of supervised offenders generally. Now, many offenders on probation, parole, or other form of supervised release are subject to a condition requiring them to submit to warrantless searches by probation officers, law enforcement officers, or both. Courts generally uphold these conditions on the basic premise that offenders under community supervision do not enjoy the absolute liberty to which every citizen is entitled. Now, we're going to be talking about a case called Griffin versus Wisconsin here in just a minute, okay? So it is one of the leading cases in which the court analyzes such searches differently depending on the purpose of the search and who is doing the searching. All right, so again, supervising offenders is a little bit different. The court has recognized that those people are different than the law-abiding citizens, and so they need to be under some level of supervision even though they are not in jail. They are technically still in custody of the state. They're just released on probation. They're supervised on probation, okay? So let's talk about supervisory searches by a probation officer. In the case Griffin versus Wisconsin, and that's gonna be a key case, so just listen to what it had to say. Probation officers searched a probationer's home without a warrant pursuant to a state administrative regulation that allowed such searches with reasonable grounds to believe the offender possessed contraband. The court upheld the search, reasoning that a state's operation of probation system presents special needs beyond normal law enforcement. Because a probation officer not only enforces the law, but is also supposed to have in mind the welfare of the probationer, the court deemed it reasonable to dispense with the warrant requirement. So again, the courts are looking at those people on probation different than those people who are not on probation, and that they have special needs, okay, beyond normal law enforcement, meaning under the supervision of police as they roam around through society. And so as such, probation officers have more ability to conduct a search. So in this case, the court described reasonable grounds, all right? Well, reasonable grounds is much different than probable cause in order to conduct a search. And so the courts realize that probation officers, in order for them to do their job, need a lower level of standard in which to conduct a search. So an investigatory search is by a law enforcement officer in reasonableness. And this is by a law enforcement officer in working with probation and dealing with those people who are on probation. And specifically, two cases come to mind here. One is U.S. versus Knights, and the other one is Sampson versus California. And you can see the citation there. In the case of United States versus Knights, as part of a criminal investigation, a law enforcement officer searched the home of a man he knew to be on probation. The officer also knew the probationer was subject to a search condition that required him to submit to searches, quote, at any time with or without a search warrant or an arrest warrant or reasonable cause by any probation officer or law enforcement officer, end of quote. The officer found evidence related to the criminal investigation, which the probationer then sought to suppress. He argued that the warrantless search was improper under Griffin because it was for an investigatory rather than supervisory purposes. Now, the Supreme Court upheld the search, but not under the special needs rationale. Instead, it applied a traditional reasonableness inquiry, balancing, quote, on the one hand, the degree to which the search intrudes upon an individual's privacy, and on the other, the degree to which it is needed for the promotion of legitimate governmental interests, end of quote. As to the intrusion into the probationer's privacy, the court noted that inherent in the very nature of probation is that probationers do not enjoy the absolute liberty to which every citizen is entitled. Moreover, the probation condition itself, of which Nice was unambiguously informed, further diminishes expectation of privacy. As to the governmental interest, the court stressed that probationers are more likely than the ordinary citizen to violate the law. The court held that the balance of these considerations requires no more than a reasonable suspicion to conduct a search of this probationer's house. Because the search at issue in this case was supported by individualized suspicion, the court did not have to consider whether a suspicionless search by a law enforcement officer would be reasonable. So Here again, the standard that the officer used was a reasonableness standards. He had probably received some information that maybe this guy was involved in some activity. Maybe the person that gave him that information was a, you know, could have been maybe the guy's mom or maybe a confidential informant. But the court basically said that that reasonableness standard is what allowed the officer to conduct that search on someone on probation. Because remember, when you're on probation, you do give up that Fourth Amendment privilege. The other case that is referenced here is Sampson versus California. With no individualized suspicion at all, a law enforcement officer searched a parolee who had agreed, as required by law, to be subject to search or seizure by a parole officer or other peace officer at any time of the day or night, with or without a search warrant and without cause. The officer found drugs which the parolee sought to suppress. Picking up where it left off in Knights, the court upheld the search. As in Knights, the search condition itself further diminished the parolee's already reduced expectation of privacy. Moreover, on the continuum of state-imposed punishments, parolees have fewer expectation of privacy than probationers. Therefore, even a suspicionless search of a parolee is not unreasonable under the Fourth Amendment. So remember, the difference between someone on probation and someone on parole is typically probationers commit a lesser offense, and most times if you're granted probation, it is in lieu of, for example, going to county jail, whereas parolees have been in state prison and so obviously are under a greater level of supervision than perhaps somebody on probation. Prison guards, again, prison guards and the rights of inmates in terms of searches. Remember, the amendment prohibits only unreasonable searches and seizures. Thus, regulations are viewed as reasonable to maintain security and order in an institution may be justified. Okay? And then you can take a look at this first sentence I gave out to you here. Two principal types of searches occur in prisons, searches of cells and searches of persons. In Hudson versus Palmer, the Supreme Court made clear that the Fourth Amendment does not apply within the confines of the prison cell. That doesn't mean that correctional officers are immune. It just means that they can't go in and, for example, purposely break somebody's TV or damage their property. But they can go in and conduct a search, right? And they don't need to have reasonable suspicion or probable cause. Searches of the person may be conducted at different levels of intrusiveness, metal detectors, pat-down searches, clothed inmates, a visual strip search, nude, those type of cases where you're searching body cavities and so forth. Key cases for the U.S. Supreme Court on searches of inmates are U.S. versus Hitchcock, a warrantless search of a cell is not unreasonable. Bell versus Wolfsfish, strip searches of body cavities after contact visits may be carried out when the need for such searches outweighs the personal right invaded. And in Hudson versus Palmer, officials may search cells without a warrant and seize materials found there in the cell. Okay, so this is just a short overview. You can go back and look at this at your leisure if you want, but this gives you some idea of what is required to conduct a search by each of these practitioners in the criminal justice system. So as you think about this in terms of collaboration, because one of the issues on the discussion board is, can you provide an example of collaboration involving a search? Well, think about if a police officer has reasonable information, creates reasonable suspicion that someone on probation or parole is engaged in narcotics activity. How can you tie that into an example of which these two elements, these two components of the criminal justice system collaborate with each other and conduct a legal search? Okay. All right, I hope that helps. If you have any questions, please let me know. You can call, text, or email me, and I'll be happy to be back as soon as I can. Thanks so much, and have a good week.